Hello and welcome to season two of I Helped Make That. For the premiere of I Helped Make That, we have a legend. What do the jerk, Annie, Planes, Trains, and Automobiles, Home Alone, Friends, Seinfeld, Barry, all of them have in common? Why, our guest, Larry Hankin, has been in all of them. Welcome to the show, Larry.
Thank you very much.
But we are not talking about any of those things today. Instead, I've got a confession for everyone. I've never seen an episode of Breaking Bad or Better Call Saul.
Wow, that's amazing.
I know, but you know who has and has also been in Breaking Bad? Why, Larry Hankin, of course. Isn't that right, Larry?
Well, yeah, I've seen most of both of them. Yeah, I've stopped watching television lately. So that was a couple of years ago. Breaking Bad and Better Call Saul. I was never on Better Call Saul. I checked to see if I was on it. I watched it and then I wasn't on it, so I stopped watching it.
Yeah, but even though he wasn't on Better Call Saul, he was in El Camino, a Breaking Bad movie.
However, APD sources say a local man who was a student of Lights before joining him in the drug trade. Together, the two were responsible for the largest methamphetamine manufacturing operation in U.S. history. Sources speculate the two had a falling out, after which it is believed to be manufacturing the drug.
Go for Joe.
And we are going to be talking about El Camino, and I have watched it in the eyes of a newcomer. But before we begin, let's get the anchor ad out of the way. Larry, have you ever wanted to create a podcast?
Yeah.
What would your podcast be about?
Well, that's what stopped me from thinking about doing a podcast. I couldn't come up with anything, so I forgot it, or I dismissed it. But I thought about it, but yeah, I mean, what would I talk about? I know what I would talk about for maybe one show, but I mean, to do a podcast like weekly or, you know, regularly, so to do anything regularly, I don't know if it's in my... in my wheelhouse. It would be pretty tough. I don't know how you guys do it and you girls do it.
Well, that's the thing about podcasts. You don't have to do them weekly. You can do them bi-weekly. You can do them monthly. You can do them whenever you want.
Well, actually then you just brought something to mind. I think I might be doing an actual podcast, a regular podcast monthly. When you said monthly, it reminded me. Yeah, they approached me. A podcasting company approached me and with a guy named Avi. I don't know his last name, who would be my partner. So I guess didn't want to let me go on alone, which I appreciated because I don't know what to do month to month. I run out of topics very, very quickly. So Avi called me and said he wanted to do a podcast with me through this company that he's with. So we may start in, I don't know, August, September, in the end of August or beginning of September, I might be doing a monthly podcast. I don't know anything about it. He just called me, says, hey, you want to do a podcast with me? And we did one podcast together, his show. And so he interviewed me and we talked for an hour and then he called me back and he said, hey, yeah, we did a good show. So let's do a monthly regular thing. So I said, yeah, fine. He seemed like a nice guy. He's in another time zone, I think. So, I mean, we're not like neighbors or friends or anything. It was just, we did this one podcast. He said, cool, let's do another one. So I might actually be doing a podcast, but I don't know about what or anything. I just left that up to Avi. But yeah.
Well, do you know what he might be putting his podcast on? Like what network?
No, I don't know anything about it. You know now as much as I do. That was the whole thing, and I just let it go. I said, yeah, I'm on the telephone. I said, yeah, well, sure, let's do it. When do you want to do this monthly thing? And he said, well, you know, we're setting it up now, the publicity and stuff, you know, to get it going. So we're setting that up, and then he'll get back to me when it's all set up so that he can give me a definite yes, we're doing it, and I guess I'll send a contract or something. But it seemed kind of easy from what we did together in his one podcast. And he seemed to be glib enough and, you know, intelligent enough to carry on, you know, month to month. And the other kind of thing that I kind of liked about it was something you brought up, was that we didn't have to do it on a regular, you know, day of the month, every month. He said we could, you know, bank them. We could just tape them and do them whenever we, you know, was okay. But they would be put on the air once a month. So that was kind of cool. Is that what you do?
Well, I actually do it weekly. And though I use Zoom,
yeah,
what some people use is Anchor. Now, I don't know if Avi uses Anchor, but the reason many people use Anchor is because it is like the easiest podcasting platform to use.
He seemed to be pretty, mysterious guy named Avi. No, he seemed to be pretty knowledgeable, and I think we're going to do it on either Zoom or StreamYard. I mean, there's a whole bunch of them. You can do, I don't care which one. As long as it gets out there, you know, it gets on the internet. But you do it weekly, but do you do it weekly on a schedule, or do you just tape them and then release them weekly, you know, regularly?
I try to do it on a schedule myself, and I always try to put them through Anchor because, you know, it's like the easiest platform to use. You know, you just put on, I personally take it from Zoom, put it on Anchor, and then through Anchor, I can put it on Spotify, Apple Podcasts, all the platforms.
Well, that's what he's thinking of doing. I don't know what he's thinking of doing, but that sounds pretty intelligent to me.
So everyone, if you want to record on Anchor, you can do that. Or if you want to use Anchor to just post a podcast you recorded from Zoom, you can do that as well. But at the end of the day, consider Anchor for your podcasting services.
Okay. I'll do that, and I'll pass that on to Avi. He seems to be in charge of that.
I've got a question about Breaking Bad.
Okay.
Did you audition for Old Joe, or were you, what's the word, asked to be on?
Well, that's a good question. I auditioned. But there's an asterisk next to that. I auditioned and because I watched Breaking Bad and I really wanted to be on it. So I was like a fan of the show. And so when they called me and they said, or my agent called me and said, no, they just called me. They called me just at my number. I don't know where they got it from. The production company called me and said, hey, you want to be on? I go, yeah, great. And they said, okay, well, you have to audition. I said, fine. But it was only five lines. So I thought, great, because I'm dyslexic and I was, which makes it very hard for me to memorize long speeches. But this was only five lines and that's easy. So I said, yeah, and I auditioned for the five lines. I was the only person auditioning. Generally, there's a whole room full of people auditioning for anything. But I was the only one there. So that made me suspect that somebody had just gotten fired and they just had to replace somebody really fast. That's generally what happens if there's nobody else auditioning. You know, they just call, hey, can you get down here right now? So I did the five lines, and that was really easy. As a matter of fact, it was so easy, I thought, well, do you want me to do it again? Or I said, no. I mean, all it was an empty room, a camera on a tripod, and this assistant, you know, that was it. It was an empty room. There's no furniture in it, just a rug, a tripod, and a chair that I could either sit or stand to do my audition, and this assistant who didn't know what was going on. And so I did my five lines. I said, well, you want me to do it again? This little back and forth. I said, well, do you want me to do it again? And she said, well, do you want to do it again? And I go, well, do I have to do it again? And she said, well, only if you want to do it again. And I said, well, I don't want to do it again, but if you want me to do it again, I'll do it again. And she said, no, you don't have to do it again. And so I said, I don't want to do it again. So I left. So that was the entire audition. And I didn't know whether I would get it or not. But I liked that little back and forth thing. I thought it was very funny. So I left, and then I get a phone call and said, you got the job. I said, great, I'm going to be on Breaking Bad. This is so cool. So when I got there, I had five lines, and I did my five lines in the morning. And then they say, hey, don't leave. We want you to be in something else. You know, so have lunch, and then we're going to shoot this other thing. And I said, wow, that's cool. Okay, so fine. So I went back to my dressing room. And on my dressing room was a full page that Vince Gilligan said, hey, write this old Joe, write him a soliloquy. It was about keeping the, I don't know if you, have you ever, you, oh, you say you haven't never watched Breaking Bad, right?
No.
Okay. Well, for those of you who have watched, it was where I try to keep the cop out of the Winnebago because Brian and Aaron were hiding in there. And this was on my junkyard property, and the cop wanted to search the Winnebago, and I wanted to keep them out because I knew they were hiding in there. So I had this long legal soliloquy about you can't go in there because this law and this law and this law and this law. You know, just a lot of legalese for a page. And I knew I couldn't memorize it. I mean, I would need like maybe 3 or 4 days to memorize a page. That's dyslexia. But I had 2 hours before I had to memorize it. So I tried as best I could to stuff it in my head, but it just wasn't working, man. I mean, dyslexia has its own schedule. So I decided to improvise it because I had been in Second City in the committee. So I was an improviser. I thought, you know, hey, I can. So I didn't tell anybody because I generally don't cop to anything that I can't do. You know, it's the old actor's thing. Hey, can you ride a horse? Yeah. You just say yes to whatever. And so I said, yeah, sure. Okay. You know, I'll see you in 2 hours. So when the 2 hours came up, I went on the set and they said, yeah, you ready, Larry? And I said, yeah. And I figured I'm going to improvise this. I can do this. So I got way back. And I said, and I also had it figured out how I could fool them. I said to the director, I said, hey, you know, I know how to film this. And I don't think any actor ever said that to a director. Hey, I know how to film this. So he didn't get mad, but he certainly got on a high horse. And he folded his arms across his chest and he goes, oh, really, Larry, you know how to direct this? Well, let's hear that. So I just told him, I said, well, see, we'll break it up, you know, like, you know, we'll do a shot of him and then a shot in the inside and then a shot on me and then shot on the cop. See, and I thought in between their setups, I could memorize the next section, which was very crafty. And he just looked at me and he smiled and he said, no, we're just going to do it walk and talk. We're just going to do it in one shot. And then you can go home after one take. We're going to just do this in one take. I said, okay, well, I'm going to improvise this no matter what. So I went down there and I just started to improvise the thing, walking and talking. And all my rules to me was don't stutter, don't stop talking, don't say just keep talking. And I improvised the whole thing. I knew the first line and I knew the last line. And I think I knew one or two lines in between, but not the whole thing. So I just did it. I just walked and I talked and I was improvising my way to the camera. And then I remembered the last line and I said it as I got to the camera. And I expected to be fired. I mean, that was the whole thing. So I had fired myself before I started to go to the set. I fired myself in my head. So I'd be ready and it wouldn't, you know, throw me when I did get fired. So I got to the end and I expected to be fired. And he said, well, that's great. Let's do it again. Just one more, just for insurance. And I go, what? Did I actually memorize that whole thing? Holy cow. So I said, now I can, okay, fine. I just go back. Now I can screw up. I mean, they got it in the can. He said so. This is just insurance. So I just improvised the whole thing again. Of course, you can't improvise exactly what I improvised. I was making up kind of new stuff, you know. But I did it again. And at the end of it, he goes, great, Larry, you're dismissed. Thank you very much. And he put me in this car, because we were out in the desert. It was shot out in the desert. So it was about a 40-minute ride back to the production company and civilization. So I got in this car, and they drove me back, and I wondered what the hell happened. And I waited 2 weeks to see the show, to see what I did. I mean, I had no idea what he was going to do. So anyway, what he did was brilliant. And he knew. Because before I got in the car, I said, who wrote this? And she said, the script girl, script lady, she said, the director wrote it. Vince Gilligan asked the director to write a scene for old Joe, a new scene. So he wrote this. So he directed. So he knew. He never said anything, but he knew that I was making it up. He wrote the scene, and I was just making crap up. So he did, but he never said anything. Not the first time, not the second. They just, great, let's do it again. Fine, you're dismissed. Boom. So I watched the show because I couldn't say what the heck he was thinking. He's just going to cut the character out totally and just throw it away. But what he did was great. He saw that after I said the second line the first time, he knew I was making it up, but he didn't say anything. Let me go through it. He said, let's do it again. What he did was, he edited together a voiceover between my two takes that kept the cop out of the Winnebago. In other words, with my improvisation between the two takes, I managed to legally keep the cop out of the Winnebago. And so if you watch the scene, you don't really have to, but when you watch a scene, what you see is the cop, they kept the camera on the cop or Aaron or Brian, and they just cut to me three times to say one line that was correct and fit, you know, and the rest, you know, whatever, because it was edited, so it was chopped up. But he cut me, so basically I'm in the scene 10 seconds, I timed it. It takes 2 seconds to say one line on camera, blah, 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 blah. And I said the correct line at the right time three times. So that's three times, let's see, 2, 4, 6, probably 3 minutes, 3, 6, and 9 minutes, 9 seconds. I was in the entire scene.
I'm the owner of this lot, which means you're trespassing on private property. As far as the IV goes, it seems to me it's locked, which means you're trying to break and enter. So I say again, you got a warrant?
Well, I don't need one if I've got probable cause, counselor.
Probable cause usually relates to vehicles, is my understanding, you know, traffic stops and whatnot.
See these round rubber things? There's wheels. This is a vehicle.
This is a domicile, a residence, and thus protected by the Fourth Amendment from unlawful search and seizure.
Look, buddy, why don't you just go
out? Did you see this drive in here? How do you know it runs? Did you actually witness any wrongdoing? It seems to me you're just out here fishing. Don't see that holding up in a court of law.
But that was really clever. So that's my big Breaking Bad story. But Vince Gilligan knew I had been making it up. I'd been improvising. Now it worked. It was a great scene. I asked all my friends. They didn't know the difference. You said, yeah, you're walking and talking and keeping them out of the thing. I mean, there was no, didn't say it looked fake or anything like that. But Vince Gilligan knew that I was making it up because he read this, the writing, and then he saw the scene. So he was very hesitant to hire me again, because he knew I didn't memorize lines, and Vince Gilligan loves to write long speeches. Better Call Saul, it's just all speeches. He never called me to do that. But all the other people in Breaking Bad were recalled to do Better Call Saul, except Old Joe. Old Joe never appeared on Better Call Saul, but that's why. So that's my Breaking Bad story.
But despite you not being on Better Call Saul, you did appear on Breaking Bad again, and you were in El Camino. Were you surprised given that previous experience?
Yes, I was very surprised. And when I got on Breaking El Camino, I did go up on my lines three times, and Vince got really pissed off because he was directing, not this other guy who was directing Breaking Bad. It was Vince Gilligan who wrote the script, and Vince Gilligan who raised the money, and Vince Gilligan who was directing the movie, the feature. So he took a break and he comes over to me. I mean, he got mad. He didn't get mad. I mean, he just got a little perturbed. That was all. And he came over to me. He said, hey, Larry, just go over there. We're going to take a little break for 10 minutes. Go over your lines, memorize them, okay? That's what he said. You go over there, memorize them, it's okay. We'll take a break, it's okay. So that's what I did. But now that he spoke to me, and it was Vince Gilligan, and I just, you know, he's my idol, and he's a great, great TV filmmaker. He's a great writer. So it was really funny. Everybody else in the scene just stood around while I'm trying to memorize my lines. They were just watching me try to memorize these lines. So all the other actors were just, oh, look at this guy. He's really working, trying to memorize his lines. Which, because they don't, you know, I mean, if you want to be an actor, you got to know how to memorize lines. So,
well, of course.
Not to be able to memorize your lines is not an actorly thing. That's very rare. Actors know how to memorize. I'm not an actor. I never pretended. I pretend to be an actor, but I never wanted to be an actor. I just fell into it, and the money is great. So I'd say, okay, fine, let's act, you know. But I never went to school. I never dreamed of being an actor. So I got my acting chops together and I got it memorized finally. It wasn't a long speech, about a half a page, but I finally did it, and you know, it worked and it looks great. I watched them. You wouldn't know that Vince talked to me about memorizing my lines, but after that he never called me again. Everybody loves Old Joe. I mean, they really like the character. And I did two Breaking Bads, and then the movie. So the three of I did them three times. But Vince never called me again, and rightly so, man. I don't want to mess up his, you know, shtick, you know. But I was very happy to work for him three times. I mean, that's pretty cool. A lot of actors never work for him, so I don't carry any grudges or it's hey, you know. I never wanted to be an actor. I got dyslexia, so I deal with it, you know. It's all.
Funny you say you never want to be an actor. So how'd you even get into acting then?
I'm a stand-up comedian. That's how I started. I graduated as an industrial designer from Syracuse University. And I only went to college because my parents wanted me to. I try to be a good son, you know. Oh, because they were second generation Americans. So their fathers came over, both my parents' fathers and parents. Both my parents' parents came over from Europe. So they was, Well, actually, they were first generation. My parents were first generation, some second generation. So I went to Syracuse to be an industrial designer because I like art. See, that's my art. I wanted to be an artist, and I saw industrial design. They wanted me to go to a college, but I could pick one as long as it was near. I couldn't go, you know, to Europe or to the West Coast. We were in the East Coast. But Syracuse is near enough for them. And I saw industrial design, so I was attracted to the word design. I didn't do any research. You know, I just graduated high school. So I said, design, oh, great, that's art. That's the only reason I signed up. I said, yeah, well, okay, I'll be an industrial designer, because I thought it would be painting. But no, it was all calculus and engineering and stuff. But I was a good student because I wanted to be a good son. So I, you know, I got like kind of an A minus average. And I was going to be an industrial designer. I was going to go to Detroit and work for Ford and design modern cars, you know, futuristic cars. But when I visited Detroit and I went to the Ford Motor Company and they gave us a tour. There was a whole bunch of about eight of us, you know, a student industrial designers from, I think, four colleges. And they were going to give us a tour because we were going to be hired. And I didn't like what was going on. I thought, it's a cubbyhole stuff. I mean, it's art, but it's engineering and it's cubbyholes. You just sit around and draw all day. And I didn't like the designs. So I just told him that. He said, you know, do you want to work here? And I go, I don't know. He didn't like that answer. He wanted to, yeah, I want to work here. He said, no, I don't know, you know. I just told him the truth. And he goes, well, and then I was looking at something and he goes, you like that? And I go, and no, not really. He goes, why not? And I go, well, I expected more from Ford Motor Company. I mean, from the design. And he goes, you really don't want to work here, do you? And I go, no, not really. He says, okay. So when I got back to Syracuse, he said, they don't want you, Larry. I said, cool. So I went to my friend, my best friend at Syracuse, and he was Carl Gottlieb, who wrote all the Jaws movies. Jaws, man. But he didn't. Back then, he was in the drama department, and he wanted to be a writer, so he just fulfilled his dream. So I said, where are you going? We were going to graduate at the same time. And he said, I'm going to Greenwich Village to be a writer. And I said, that sounds cool. Do you want a roommate? He said, yeah, let's go. I don't have any money. So we became roommates. I went to Greenwich Village, and I was a funny guy in high school. So he became a writer for newspapers in New York, being a writer, getting those chops. And I just worked in a bar from 2 a.m. to 6 a.m., you know, just cleaning up, you know, sweeping up peanut shells and stuff, and stealing food from the It was a bar and grill. That was how I fed myself and paying half the rent. And I started to go to stuff, you know, the coffee house in Greenwich Village. So I would, you know, I had to do something at night before going to work at 2 a.m. So I hung around in the coffee houses and I'm watching open mic nights. And I go, hey, I can do that. I'm a funny guy. So that's what I did. So I got up on stage and I worked out a little, you know, hunk of funny stuff. It took me 6 months. I mean, I'm a slow learner, but once I get there, I get pretty good. And then after 6 months, I was opening for Woody Allen and Miles Davis and the Kingston Trio. I'm in show business. And then I got into critical thinking. I was watching Richie Pryor and George Carlin and Lenny Bruce. And I go, oh, that's cool. I want to do that kind of humor. So then Cops started pulling me off the stage, and I didn't like that at all.
Oh, like a Marvelous Mrs. Maisel.
Well, like Lenny Bruce, but heavy duty. I mean, she's not doing heavy duty. Well, now you can, as John Stewart said a couple of weeks ago, he said, you couldn't curse back then. They drove Lenny Bruce to drugs, and they just, you know, beat him up. But nowadays they're naming sitcoms after curse words. I mean, so it's different now. When I was being pulled off the stage, you know, for saying fuck and crap and sex, drugs, and rock and roll, now you can say anything on television. It's fine, which is cool. But those guys broke through, Lenny and George and Richie. And they were great. They were really good. Now, you know, now Bill Burr's taken over kind of, and Joe Coy. So yeah, but I didn't like being pulled off the stage by cops. So my manager, who was Woody's manager, Jack Rollins, he said, well, you know, join Second City. You know, they're doing what Carlin and Lenny is doing, but they own the theater. So the cops can't come in and throw you out, you know. So that's what I did. That's how I got into show business. From Second City, we broke away, went to San Francisco and opened our own company called The Committee. And that became very famous and as big as Second City. We were part of San Francisco's tourist attraction. And that's just a hop, skip, and a jump from LA, $35, back in 60s, $35 round trip, plane flight from LA to San Francisco and then back. So all the casting directors were flying up and hiring us just for a day or a week. And we didn't care. It was a great gig because we had a steady job in San Francisco. There was lines around the block to get into our theater. And then we just go down and make incredible amounts of money for a day, like $5,000 or $1,000 for a day or a week or whatever. And then go back and make our $250 or $300 a week on as a stage show, you know, doing 9 shows a week. And you go down there and just rehearse once a day, make the money. So that's really how I got in. And then the first company that started the Second City, started the Committee in San Francisco, they started to not come back from LA. You know, they go down for a day or a week for $5,000 and then they stay down there, get a manager or an agent, and they stay down there for the money. And that's what I did finally. So that's all right. How I did the show business.
Oh, that's interesting to hear. And I think many character actors actually start off like that, not going into acting, actually having acting be their first thing. I know Edie McClurg, who I know you've been in a few movies
with. Yeah, I know Edie. She's a good friend of mine. Well, she was a good friend.
Yeah, I heard about her developing dementia recently.
Yeah.
Yeah, but I heard that before she got into acting, she was into radio. Then she did The Groundlings.
And probably The Groundlings, but the Pistol Players is where I know her from, San Francisco. Okay.
All right, the Pistol Players and
no,
The Groundlings.
The Pistol Players.
Oh, the Pistol Players. All right. I knew she was in like 2 improv clubs. I read about it, and that got her into acting and got her into comedy.
Right. But she was great, man. I've acted with her. She played my wife, and she's having a baby. So we worked together in LA and also in San Francisco. We used to improvise together because she would come to the Committee and improvise with us. And then, because we were about 10 blocks away from our theaters. She was in the Pitchell Players Theater and I was in the Committee's Theater. So we had different days off. We'd come and improvise with each other. She's great.
Yeah. But back to Breaking Bad and El Camino. Now that we've talked about the making of it, it is now time to talk about the movie itself. And as a Breaking Bad virgin, I don't know if there is an official term for people who've never seen Breaking Bad. I feel like there must be something. I would say that, though I have yet to watch Breaking Bad, I have yet to find the time for it, because there are so many damn shows on streaming alone right now.
Thank God I get residuals for all of them. But yeah, it probably bothers you. I love it.
It only bothers me in that I that there are so many choices out there.
Actually, I'm
on many shows that are on streaming, but most of them I've been a background actor on, and background actors do not get residuals, sadly.
Oh, wow. Oh, sad. That's pretty bad.
Well, at least non-union background actors don't get residuals. I don't know about union. I would think that...
Neither. I've never background. That was one of the... Well, I've never background actor. I don't know if I can do that regularly. Because I want to, I'm a performer. I want to step out of the line and get up front,
Back to El Camino. I would say that even though I haven't had the time to watch Breaking Bad or Better Call Saul, though I will say I love Barry.
Oh, yeah, thank you. If you saw me in it, I liked what I did in Barry.
Yeah. But anyway, back to Breaking Bad for the third time. Feels like we keep stalling this. Well, back to El Camino specifically. Sure. I would say that surprisingly, I think maybe not having watched anything else in the Breaking Bad verse, or again, whatever they call it, might have helped.
What do you call it? The Breaking Bad verse.
Oh, they do call it the Breaking Bad verse?
No, but that's a great way to call it.
Anyway, I would say that maybe having not watched anything else Breaking Bad related helped me enjoy the movie more.
Yeah.
Because, outside of the obvious memes like Heisenberg or whatever, I don't know much about the story or the characters.
You didn't bring anything to it. You didn't have any preconceived conceptions. So that was great that you came open to, here's a new thing.
Exactly.
It's great. You probably enjoyed it more than anybody who watched the show, the TV show.
Exactly.
I'm curious about that.
Exactly, because seeing as I'm just viewing it as its own thing, I don't have any judgments on where I think the characters would end up. But more than that, I think it actually kind of gave it sort of a cool mystery. Like there was sort of a cool mystery of who Jesse was, who all these people he kept running into was, how they knew him, like what his life was like beforehand, which actually might have made it more interesting, because to me, seeing as I don't know much about this world at all, it's like I'm learning more about the world, piecing things together as I'm watching the movie. Now, there are a couple things that didn't make sense to me that probably would have made more sense to me if I watched the show, like who Christian Ritter's character was. But for the most part, I think they explain enough about these characters that if you've never watched the show, you're not too lost. But also didn't explain too much that it feels like you're being spoon-fed.
Vince is a great writer. I mean, he takes those things into consideration when he writes it. But I think that you got a better take of what the movie was and was about than anybody who watched the show Breaking Bad, because frankly, I watched a lot of the shows because I was hooked on the show. And then when I got part, that was really great. And I had a reference point being in El Camino, because I knew I had a backstory already from being in the TV show to what my character was and what the relationships were. It was already set up from the TV show. But as a watcher of the TV show and the movie wasn't quite as good as the TV show. But you don't know that. So you came fresh and you just accepted the movie as what the movie was, what it was, not what I wanted it to be or expected it to be, because I know the TV show and I know who all these people are. So I think you got the better end of the deal, really, by not watching the TV show.
What makes you say that?
Well, because I watched both and I had expectations. You know, I was old Joe and I was in the TV show and I knew the nuances of Vince Gilligan's writing because I had watched it, you know, like 10, 15, 20 shows. However, I watched a series of episodes. So I built up, wow, Vince Gilligan writes great characters. Oh, these actors are really great. Oh, I'm following all the lines of the different characters. And I'm also looking at how Vince wrote scenes because I'm a writer more than I am an actor. So I was studying how the show was put together, where they put the camera, how what the action was. I was deconstructing each scene as a writer. I was using it not only as a viewer, but as a learner, a writing learner. And so that's how I was watching the show. So when I watched the movie, I was expecting to see a movie coming in fresh, just like I go to any movies, because you only see it once. So I just enjoy it. A TV show, you can, over a series of episodes, you can stop just enjoying it and you can start to deconstruct it. You can start to see how he's moving different characters and where they come from, where they're going, and how he does that. So when I watched the movie, I expected to watch a movie. But I saw, wow, this isn't, he's cutting corners. He's forcing things, you know, because I had reference points. You didn't. So that's better for you. And I was missing the movie because I was being, I was comparing instead of watching and enjoying. I was comparing. And since Vince just had an hour and a half to get an entire arc of a narrative, whereas in a TV show, episodic, you have an entire season to get your arc straight. I mean, you don't write the entire arc before the first show. They kind of sketch it out, but in a TV show, they write about 3 or 4 or 5 or 6 episodes ahead. They do clock that right out. But then once they start getting into seeing the show, they start to fuck with the other episodes that are after the 7th or 8th show. They leave it so they can move things around. So they base the last part of the episode of that year based on what they've done the first part. But making a movie, you don't have that, you know, that time frame of putting it out, watching it grow, and then adjusting it. You got to do the whole thing all at once. Boom. And so you don't have the pleasure, the time to fix things. So you're stuck with what you wrote, you know, 3 months ago. Now we're shooting it. But in a TV show, you're not stuck with what you wrote 3 months ago. You still got 3 months to go. You can still fix it. You can still. So again, that's what I was watching when I was watching a movie. I was deconstructing and making judgment calls about it. Oh, well, it was more exciting. In other words, the danger in the TV episodes was much more palpable, much more aimed, because they had time to, oh, well, we did that last week. Let's like up the stakes a little here. But in a movie, you can't do that. You got to, if we up the stakes here, we got to change the ending and we don't have time to do that because we're on a shooting schedule and time is money. So that's how I was watching. And then I was judging my own character again, judging, you know, seeing, okay, I had to say these words and I had to drive a truck and I had to hit Aaron. I don't know if you remember that scene, but I got out of the truck and I have this thing that, oh, hi, I had to establish in 2 seconds, and Vince was directing. So here's a little hint for directors out there. In the script, it says, in my scene, it says he gets out of the truck and he greets Aaron's character, whatever his name was. I can't remember his name. Pinkman, Jesse Pinkman. So he greets Jesse Pinkman. He says, "Hey, how you doing, kid?" And then Jesse's character says, "Come on with me." And he takes me into the back where the El Camino is. So I get out of the truck and I say, "Hey, how you doing, kid?" Now, "How you doing, kid," refers to, in the TV show, I have a relationship in the TV show, a very long relationship with both Brian's character and Jesse Pinkman's character. I've known them for years. I've been destroying their stolen cars, and Jesse's stolen cars, for years in the TV show. In the movie, all I do is show up in this truck. He's calling a friend that he's dealt with for years, but if you're just watching the movie for the first time, you don't know that. But all of a sudden, I get out of the car and I say, "Hey, how you doing, kid?" That's supposed to, in Vince Gilligan's mind, set up a relationship. "How you doing, kid?" Like, "Oh, we know each other." So that shows, oh, they're friends. So now he can just go in the back and tell him to get rid of this El Camino. So I get out of the thing. So they're filming it now. Take one. I get out of the truck. I say, "Hey, how you doing, kid?" He says, "Yeah, I'm doing great. Come on back in the back and I'll show you the car." And then we cut. And then Vince comes up to me and he says, "It doesn't set up the character that we don't know. It's not good enough." He says, "It's not good enough to show the relationship. We've got to show the relationship that it's an old relationship. How do we do that?" And he thought for a second, you know, I mean, like he's thinking on his feet. So, and then he says, "Okay, here's what you do, Larry. When you get out of the truck and you say, 'Hey, how you doing, kid?' Give him a pat on the cheek." So in other words, it makes it, you're even closer. You're not just saying it. You know him so well, you can say, "Hey, how you doing, kid?" You know, like a fatherly thing, you know, which sets up a relationship that you can do that to this guy. So I said, "Okay." So I get out of there. No, he just tells it to me. Jesse was off talking to his friends or something. He wasn't listening to this conversation. So he doesn't know what I'm going to do. So I get out of the truck. Okay, take two. Get out of the truck and I go, "Hey, how you doing, kid?" Boom. And I go, "Hey, how you doing, kid?" And he goes, "Okay, come on, let's go in the back." They cut and I see Vince walking towards me. So he's going to give me another note. But Aaron looks at me, you know, I just go boom like that. He goes, "Hey, man, what did you hit me in the face for?" So I go, "Well, no, Vince said, you know, we're trying to set up a relationship here." He goes, "Oh, okay. All right, fine. Cool." Then Vince comes over to me after that little conversation. Jesse walks away and Vince comes up to me and he says, "No, you're afraid to hit him. No, give him a good friendly slap in the face, man. You know, this guy, I mean, you babysat for this guy. I mean, he's trying to give me a backstory, you know. You babysit for this guy. You know this guy for years. You raised him." Okay, all right, fine. So, okay, let's do it. Take three. I get out of the truck and I go, "Bam, how you doing, kid?" And he goes, "All right, come on in the back. I'll show you the El Camino." Great, cut. Vince says, "All right, moving on." And Jesse says, "What the fuck did you just do, man? You're just like, hey, you know, don't hit me that hard. What are you?" He got really mad because I just whacked him. But Vince said, "Yeah, that sets up the character. That's cool."
Where's Victor?
It's in the back. Look, thank you so much for doing this, Joe. It's about the money, if we can...
Maybe. It's on the house. Good kid. Least they can do.
He says, moving on. He didn't do a fourth take. So it's little things like that that you don't run into in the TV thing that you run into the movie thing. You know, Vince has got to think on his feet and he's got to push it. And if Jesse doesn't like me hitting him in the face, too bad, Jesse. I that's what I had to say to Jesse. I said, no, Vince told me to hit you that hard. I didn't want to hit you at all. I mean, you're a star of the movie, man. So I had to explain myself to him. So little things like that happen on the set. That makes it kind of worthwhile going to work. You know, the little new things that, I just hit him too hard. Or I get to hit the star of the movie really hard. Then he can't say anything because Vince told me to.
I know what you're saying about how watching TV shows and then movies that are like the like the finale or the continuation about them can, you know, alter your mind of the movie. Yeah. I will say that watching this movie now first before Breaking Bad or Better Call Saul definitely now makes me want to see the show. You know, when, yeah, of course. You know, when I get past the other 8,000 shows on streaming, I want to watch. But yeah, I will. But I will say, yeah, there are many times I've seen like movies based on TV shows where I'm like, that doesn't connect with that, or how does that lead to that, or whatever.
Because mainly, I would say to that, because I get that feeling too, and mainly that's because the show, the TV show, is so popular that it's greed. Oh, we can make more money if we made this into a movie. We would get even 10 times as many, you know, viewers, but we get box office, you know, and it's not relegated to, you only get this much amount of money each show. But now we can double that, triple that if we just make one movie and it goes all over the world. It's greed. So they don't, it's very hard to write a sequel because that's not what the writer had in mind when he wrote the first thing. He was inspired by desire, and a sequel or a spin-off is not created by inspiration or desire. It's created by greed. And that's why generally spin-offs don't work as well. It's not inspiration, it's greed. You want more money, so let's just make a movie. There's no inspiration about, oh, I got this great idea for a story. Yeah, so, and sometimes they hit it on the head. Sometimes you've written it so much in the TV series that you now finally, after 7 years of doing the episodics, you understand the hero. You understand his need. Yeah, so now let's make a movie because I am inspired. Now I really understand that character, and I got a great story to show what his needs and, you know, and his growth is. So yeah, that might work. That movie might work. But generally it's just greed.
Yeah. But I do agree that the reason TV spin-offs cannot work is that, you know, sometimes some stories just work better in one medium, be they TV or movie or whatever, than another. There's been like two TV shows completely different from Breaking Bad that had movies coming out this year. Beavis and Butthead and Bob's Burgers.
Oh, right.
Yes.
No, I watched Bob's Burgers, the movie, surfing, and they were showing a movie on some streaming thing, and I go, what the hell is this? Isn't that a restaurant? I mean, that's what I'm talking about.
Yeah,
exactly.
The inspiration
and the greatness of Bob's Burgers was it was in a restaurant, so they had to make, and it's brilliant in a restaurant. There are all these people coming in and out, but once you widen it out to, you know, giant scope, you know, on a big, no, then you're just making shit up, man. Come on, get real. That's greed. That is pure, unadulterated greed.
Well, yeah.
And it shows. You know, come on.
Well, I was going to say, I saw the Bob's Burgers movie in theaters, and I was like, this is okay, but why did I travel all the way out to a theater when I could have just seen this on my TV?
Right.
Thankfully, I have a season pass, so I did not have to pay much for it, but still.
But still, I'm with you, man. But still, it's a great argument.
But I saw the Beavis and Butthead movie, and it's like, because they're just, you know, sort of idiots getting into crazy situations, like, and it was going straight to streaming. It was like, oh, this is just a fun way to kill an hour and a half. It's not the deepest movie in the world or anything by any stretch of the imagination, but, you know, just to have some fun.
Yeah, also, I kind of think, because I've run into this in my creative situations, where Beavis and Butthead is a great example. I love Beavis and Butthead, the TV show, and I would watch that every once in a while. I was attracted to it all the time, but okay, I wasn't a fan, but I liked watching it. But I could watch it because it was short. It was a half hour, and sometimes I would just tune in and watch it as much as I could watch it, laugh at these two guys and these two idiots and what they were doing. And the characterizations, you know, the way they were drawn and everything was great for a little while. But I don't know if I could watch that for an hour and a half. It becomes, certain funny things become cloying after a certain amount of time. I just get tired of it. Okay, I get it. You know, let's move on. So Beavis and Butthead, I did watch as TV, but the movie I could watch in spurts. If it was on five times at different times, I'd watch different sections of it. So I finally get the whole movie, but I couldn't watch the entire movie all at once. The other one was, what's that thing about stupidology or stupidocracy or
idiocracy?
Idiocracy. Yeah, I can only watch that. It's a great idea, but very hard to make manifest into a movie. So I would watch it in sections. So I've never seen the whole thing, but I've watched maybe 5 or 6 10-minute parts, but I just can't stick with it. But if they made that into a half hour, if they made it into a film short, I'd love it. You know, I'd watch it all the time. But so yeah, there's different mediums cause you to write it in different ways for different amounts of time. Yeah, I can totally understand that.
Yeah, actually, I made my own like podcast movie like 3 years ago. Well, it started off as a podcast movie, became a podcast miniseries because like the story was like based on true events. And it was just kind of hard to fit the story into like a movie structure because it was based on real events. And like, I even put it on the blacklist, and like, there were literally things that happened in real life that were being criticized by the readers because they didn't know it was based on a true story.
Right. Cool. Yeah.
But also there were things that felt rushed, you know, that felt kind of quickly written, not as developed as they could be, because I was trying to put in so many events in a movie structure and, you know, it just didn't work. So to give the story more time to grow, that's why I had to change it into a mini series.
Okay, yeah. But that is a writer's problem. See, but that, whether it works or not, I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about there are certain stations of the cross of TV episodics, TV one-offs, or short episodics. You know, like we'll only do 6 episodes. That's a, you know, or there's the, we're going to go for 7 years, you know, 24 episodes a year, or we're going to make a movie, and each one has its rules and trying to fit. So that's a writer's problem. That's standard procedure. You can't avoid that or learn how to go around that. So if a movie doesn't fit into the movie structure, you're fucked. I mean, you'll have, there's certain rules. And if you got a sitcom and you want to make it into the movie, see, that's the other thing. If you got a sitcom and it works, Breaking Bad is a perfect example, to El Camino. It works as a sitcom, but then you got to change the rules of how you structured it to make it into a movie. And that destroys the structure that people have as to its believability. You know, you change the structure. Now, I don't know if I believe this as much as I did when I was watching the TV show. Yeah, but that's a writer's problem. In other words, that's not just another dead end. It's a structural writing problem that you just got to learn to write for, not write around or fake. You just got to write the form. That took me years to understand. You know, I would be writing film shorts and then I would be writing a movie. Well, the structures and the rules for film shorts are different than an hour and a half narrative. And I didn't know that. So basically I was writing an hour and a half film short. And that doesn't track. You get bored real fast. And I never understood why. Well, I'm just following the rules. I wrote a great film short. Now I'm just making it an hour and a half. Why doesn't it work? Because it's not a movie structure, a film short. Yeah, but it took me a long time to understand that you got to write for the structure. But that's, like I say, a writer's problem. It's not a mistake. It's a problem that you got to solve. It's a challenge that you got to solve. Yeah.
Okay, well, I think that is a perfect place to end things.
Cool, because I've got another appointment. So yeah, cool.
Okay. Anyway, that was I Helped Make That. Thanks again, Larry, for coming on to the show.
Thank you, Kevin.
You're welcome. We'll see you all later. Bye now.